In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Hola, everybody. Welcome to an episode of the Genius Brain Podcast. We have our
Can I get some glitter?
Huh? Oh, you want that glitter cut?
Yeah. 68% fucking alcohol,
there
brother.
There we go, man. We got our very, very special guest, you know, what we call a lift god.
Oh,
what's up? AKA Salvadorian Salivator Papi.
Mango Papa.
AKA Mango Biter.
Oh, can Crusher. The Can Crusher.
The Can Crusher.
Can Crusher.
AKA In My Feelings Too Much from High School Days.
Hey, hit me up.
And we also got Nick the Wonton Ear.
What's up, baby? What's
AKA up? AKA Tonkatsu 69. You know his rapper name,
bro. Shit. His new song goes so hard. Have you heard it,
Doug? First of all, don't you ever fucking say that about anything that boy does.
I love him.
You know, dude, that fool's out of jail now, right?
Yeah.
So here's some fucking shit. So Tekashi 69, aka Snitch,
aka Hard as Fuck.
I know you like that fucking trash ass music.
Hard, bro.
All of his songs sound exactly the same.
Some of his songs are actually pretty good, but there's only a couple that
I
actually like.
I fucking hate all of his music.
But then when I listen to it afterwards, I feel like a piece of shit for actually liking him.
If y'all don't know who Tekashi 69 is, you live in a fucking rock, you guys, under a rock.
You guys should watch the, me and Tiff are watching the Charlemagne, the Breakfast Club interview with Tekashi 69.
Yeah.
That is one of the funniest things ever. These fools are going back and forth, and he's just saying, like, Tekashi's talking shit to Charlemagne, and he just goes, "Did you get your GED yet?" Like, out of nowhere. I was like, oh, fuck.
You know what the funny thing about that is, too? When you go back to that Charlemagne the God interview, number one, Charlemagne the God, you know, he's out of pocket a lot of the times. And when you listen to that interview, the people that are writing the comments are young kids. And they're like, Charlemagne the God got roasted in that conversation. I'm like, from a child's perspective, adult perspective, Tekashi 69 was saying just garbage. Mm-hmm. And the funny thing is, when a dumb person just starts to speak and they don't stutter in their sentence, they go, "That's a smart person."
Yeah.
You could do that and say a lot of stupid shit.
He's saying nonsense, bro.
Pure nonsense.
Also, I feel like he was just letting him talk because he's like, "All right, just let him talk."
Yeah, because he's literally making himself sound dumb as fuck.
And it's a weird thing, too. So if you, like, Tekashi, since the onset of his career, he's had so much drama wrapped around him. Because let's even talk about this. This motherfucker fucked a 13-year-old.
Yeah, he said that.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Charlamagne asked him, he goes, "Are you a registered sex offender?" And he's like, "Nope, you got a computer right there. Why don't you go check it?" He goes, "No, I'm asking you, are you a registered sex offender?" And he just,
dude, Charlamagne don't care, bro. That's why I like those interviews sometimes.
Motherfuckers try to fight that dude, bro.
I know, he just be saying whatever. He don't care.
Well, he is a sex offender because he did have sex with a 13-year-old, and his excuse is he goes, "She lied to me about her age."
Yeah.
Dog, I don't give a fuck.
13 years old?
You know what a 13-year-old looks like, bitch. You knew she was underage and you fucked a child, you disgusting little fuck. He was 19 at the time.
He said it was like a music video thing, right? Or some shit.
I don't give a 13-year-old looks like a fucking 13-year-old.
That shit weird, bro.
Dude, you could tell.
Jesus
Christ. What is that, seventh grade?
You could tell by what a 13-year-old looks like just by what they smell like. 13-year-olds smell. They smell like children.
All you need to do is hear her say one sentence and you're like, oh, you're 13.
Oh, you're 13. You smell like a wet backpack.
She had a backpack on the whole time.
The little kid one. Hey, yeah, she's gonna be wearing them shits.
The unicorns
for swag.
And the glitter and
she's
shit.
She's drinking
on
a juice box and shit. She has a trapper keeper.
She's like, "I got $2 of milk money. Let's go."
I know. Like, she got her fucking PE clothes on with her name on the bottom of her shorts.
And the fucking logo's all fucking messed up from getting washed every fucking day.
She has jellies on and shit.
What the fuck?
But her songs go hard though. Fuck.
All of her songs do sound the same though.
Recite some lyrics right now.
All
right,
ready?
Here we go.
"These said they heard of me. I ain't heard of you. Get the fuck up out my fucking face before I murder you." That's one of his main lines in Billy. That shit goes hard. And then what's the other one?
He does know all his fucking
lyrics. Fee, 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 foo, foo, fa, fa, fee, 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 fa, fee, fee, fee,
fee, fee, fee. Bro, it's just like what I was telling you. Like, I was telling Nick this earlier today. I was telling you, like, I like people's voices. His voice sounds sick on these songs, bro. I like, his, like, aggressive, like,
"You are never allowed on this podcast ever again."
Yeah, bro, he goes hard, bro.
All the music he likes is very aggressive and very in your face.
Yeah, bro, because, like...
And then he's like, "Oh, I love Sade."
He looks like Sade goes hard, COVID, dude.
You
that
like Sade,
so
right?
Disgusting. Yeah.
Who doesn't like Sade?
Dude, my dad used to bump her. My dad has little posters of her, like, all in the garage and shit. When we were growing up, we would see it, and he had, like, the records of it. So we used to bump that stuff all the time. I love Sade. She goes hard.
He's just a very interesting. I just hate Tekashi 69. I mean, everything about him. I think.
Yeah, he's not a good person.
I mean, a lot of these rappers aren't great people. It's just he puts it on so fucking much. You know what I mean? And also, too, like, come on, man.
In the interview, Charlamagne goes, "Why are you telling everyone to suck your dick all the time?" He's like, "Man, I don't give a fuck. Like, I want people to test my gangster all the time. Yada 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 yada." And he's over here. He's like, "Man, I want people to know that they could, like, you know, run up and we can get that smoke," and saying all that shit, right? Yeah. And then you see that video of him getting, he's throwing down at the airport. He's getting like, fighting. Him and his homies are like fighting some dudes. That motherfucker was getting beat up the whole time. Yeah. And his homies
Look at him. He doesn't look like he could throw a fucking fist.
He doesn't like he could jog around the block, bro.
Okay, because he went to jail. He was supposed to be in prison for up to, I want to say it was like 47 years. It was 47, 42 years, something along those lines, right? And basically his sentence got reduced by depending on how much he snitches.
Oh, fuck
So basically it was like, all right, your cap is 47. Give us some information. All right, 45 years.
And that shit went all the way down a month or something.
Exactly.
Right?
So it was. So he got out in like 2 years because he took his 47 or 42 year thing and he took a plea deal. And I guess what happens is that within a plea deal, and people can correct me if I'm wrong, within that plea deal, you're not being prosecuted. Now you'd be put as a witness. So now he's a government witness.
Yeah,
instead.
He's like a. And he's like on protective stuff, right? But I think, because technically he's...
I say that shit again.
Yeah, I don't know. He's on protective stuff.
Protective custody.
He's on protective stuff. No, he's supposed to still be in jail, but because he has asthma, that's why he got out even earlier.
Seriously?
Yeah, so because he's supposed to still be in jail, he's supposed to get out in like a couple more months, but because he has asthma and the coronavirus thing going on in there, the judge let him finish the sentence in his house. So that's why he's on house arrest. That's why he's at house arrest. And that's why he was able to shoot that music video. I remember it came out, he was like, he asked the judge if he was able to shoot music videos at his house and all that type of stuff, and I guess they approved it. So like that music video that he just released is all shot at his house and everything too.
He has the number 69 tatted on his face. What's up with that?
Well, he has it everywhere, bro.
So he has that number 69 tatted on his whole body over 200 times.
But also, it's on his face.
Is that what you're
worried about? Look at everything about him. He's disgusting. He looks like shit that nightmares are made out of.
Yeah.
But that's the thing too. So he snitched on everybody, right? Well, what was the gang that he was a part of? It's like some
Treyway.
Yeah, Treyway. Okay, there you go.
Treyway.
So that's the gang that he was affiliated with. Mm. It was funny because there was this thing. I'm not sure if this is what he was convicted for, but it was racketeering, like possible murder or some other shit.
Yeah, because it was something with like Chief Keef's group. I think they like had like a supposed hit out on Chief Keef, and he was like a part of it and stuff. Pretty sure that's what it was, because him and Chief Keef had beef, like some baby mama beef or something like that. And I think it was racketeering and then something where like hire for murder or something like that.
So it's interesting because I read this small thing the other day where I'm not sure if this is what they were putting on him as a charge, but there was somebody within the gang, Treyway or some shit like that. They didn't like how he was coming up. Right. So, you know, he was a little loud. Yeah, he was a little eccentric or
talks
whatever.
Talks a lot of shit.
Talks a lot of fucking shit. And so this dude was like, "Yo, I don't fucking like you. Like, you need to, you know, stay in your fucking lane. Like, you just started, you know, popping off in this gang." But other gang members were saying that he should just leave him alone because he's bringing money into the gang. So it's all good. Mm. Lo and behold, that guy that was speaking up, I forgot what his name was. I don't know, Bootsy or whatever. But, you know, whatever, Bootsy. He dies a month later.
Oh, really?
I wonder how.
Oh, shit.
I wonder
shit,
how.
Do you think 6ix9ine is going to get popped or what?
Oh, fuck. Yeah. I mean, if he does, I don't know if anybody will shed a tear, but.
I feel like. I feel pathetic. Like for him, it's kind of done, right? Like, you can't. I don't. If I was him, I wouldn't feel safe going to do a show. Like, I wouldn't feel safe, like, really going out. Even though when he was out, you saw that video, he had like 17 freaking bodyguards who were all like 9 feet tall and shit walking around him. But even with that, dude, someone's gonna get to you.
He's probably gonna be one of those guys that gets just so lucky and he's never gonna get shot or something.
Yeah, I mean, he's just over here talking to himself in his room doing an IG live. It's like, what kind of life is that shit?
Yeah.
You have all this money and you can't do anything shit with it.
Shit.
For the rest of your life, you cannot do shit with it because the moment you step out in public, somebody's gonna cap your ass. That's
it. Dude, he's done. He talked too much shit. He talked way too much shit.
Someone's gonna make an example out of him for sure.
The funny thing was, like, the amount of people he snitched on was unreal. I feel like he was snitching on people he didn't even have to snitch on.
Yeah,
he was like Cardi B. Those memes? Like, yo, what the fuck? Cardi's like, yo. Yeah,
those memes are going around. everything meme, like, oh, also judge, I know this, and they would use that picture of him in the courthouse.
But
my funny.
Question is, like, for all the things that he snitched on, how much is like the court able to prosecute on that? You know, because if they reduced his sentence by that much, they must have been a lot, right?
Like, well, he snitched on everybody that was going to go to jail with him. So it wasn't just him. It was 6ix9ine.
I think he like told on a whole gang.
He
like,
told on all of them. Gang. All of them that were going to go to jail with him. He snitched on all those motherfuckers.
Fuck.
So if he goes to prison, he's fucked. He's dead.
You were saying that they were trying to kill him before, right?
So the whole thing, from what I heard and read, is that because there's a video of him getting kidnapped. Like, he gets put in a trunk, and that's how he gets away. Yeah. He escapes, he rolls off and runs away. That's all of the people, that was all of his friends in that gang. So they had like kidnapped him and were threatening to kill him and do all this stuff on him. So those are all the people that he snitched on too.
Oh, got it.
So I'm like, obviously it's like, all right, I understand. I mean, fuck, if you guys kidnap me and try to kill me and shit, and they're like, hey, who
am
I?
Do they say, do people know why he got kidnapped?
I think it was like a money thing or some shit. I don't know.
It's either a money thing. Either way,
there's always something to it.
At the end of the day, it's not like he's completely innocent himself, because he put a hit on somebody else.
Yeah.
He put a hit on somebody else within his own gang. So it's you know, you get what you put out.
Yeah.
And honestly, like, that fool's got out, but Bobby Shmurda's still locked up, bro.
Yeah, that's crazy.
That's some like gun shit.
He didn't snitch though on somebody.
He didn't snitch. No, yeah. He actually did not snitch. I saw something. He could have gotten like some shorter sentence if he would have like snitched,
but he didn't.
So that's why he's in jail still, because he took the longer sentence because he didn't want to tell on people.
I bet that guy's living like a king over there.
Hey, some of his songs go hard too. Bobby Shmurda,
his new, what's it, the new song that he dropped, the one that he shot in his house, hit 22 million views in like in a day.
Dude, fuck. It's insane. But it's also because people are watching it. People that hate him watch it, all that type of shit. Yeah. But that's what he goes for. He likes to talk. He's almost like, if you go to MMA, he's like Colby Covington.
Yeah, he's
but
very
he's
polarizing.
Successful with it, right? He just talks so much shit.
22 million views, and then he broke the record for the most amount of IG live streams.
Yeah, I heard he was like 2 million.
Yeah, I got
2 million. That's crazy. That's insane.
Bro, I know. I usually hit like a million, but like that fool.
That boy just skyrocketed fast.
There was a video of him talking, and then in the comments you see the real Tommy Chong, and he's like, add me in.
Tommy like, Chong. Oh shit.
It's like, I was like, what are you gonna talk to this
who's Tommy Chong?
Cheech and Chong.
Oh, what the fuck?
Yeah, I know, of all people, you know?
Hey, what if Tommy Chong got in there? He's like, hey, bitch, you a snitch.
He's like, I'm gonna fucking kill you.
Don't come to my hood.
He is a snitch. It's weird how much like young people still fuck with him, though. They're like, oh, he's still dope. The weird thing about that to me anyways, I mean, it's weird kind of bringing up integrity and, you know, with this fucking piece of shit or rap or whatever, right? But something about snitches that I just don't fuck with, right? Yeah. Like, if you're a fucking snitch, like, you're done. Like, I don't give a fuck what you do. You could produce whatever great art that you want, but that snitch title right there, I don't really appreciate.
Yeah.
And it's not like he was doing the world a great service, right? Nah. Because he should be locked up too. You're trash as well.
Bro.
Yeah. And how did he even get so famous in the first place?
I mean, he just popped off.
He popped off. Gummo. Like I was saying, it's, Gummo.
That song, right?
Yeah, but
that song
like,
was actually pretty cool.
Bro, that's what I'm saying. Like,
that was actually pretty good.
I wouldn't ever fuck with him in person. Like, I wouldn't ever be homies with him, but some of his fucking songs are sick. No, he popped off because the song was catchy, because the picky, like that stuff was like new, and like the whole aggressive screaming, but you know, like rainbow hair, the rainbow grill, like all that type of shit, that shit helped him. The face tattoos,
it's like a likable character.
Got posted to get made fun of in the beginning, but it just turned out it kind of just like blew. Same with like, remember that Slim Thug kid, that little skinny white kid that like told on himself that all the stuff
that
was fake?
That shit is tight though, dude.
No, he goes hard on some of his songs too, bro.
that's
he does. But that was the same thing. He had his own little,
completely joking.
He had his own little like, you know, 15 minutes. And remember, Charlamagne had said that. Remember, he brought that up in the interview 6ix9ine. He's like, you said I was only going to have 15 minutes of fame.
Yeah.
But I guess 6ix9ine just did it smart, where he's like, all right, I just got to keep talking mad shit, or I'm for real only going to have 15 minutes of fame.
Yeah.
But that shit bit him in the ass, because he talked way too much shit,
man. He thought he was invincible. He's like, if I have enough money, if I have enough clout, nobody can touch me. People can find a way to hurt you, man.
At the end of the day, people can find...
Look, if Michael Jackson died, motherfucker, you gonna die too.
You ain't Michael Jackson, dog.
Fuck no, dude.
That's just fucking crazy, man. I just can't believe how many people fuck with that kid, dude. This podcast is brought to you by Skillshare, my friend. Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of aspiring classes for creative and curious people. explore new skills, deepen existing passions, and get lost in creativity. They've got classes for productivity, lifestyle, freelance and entrepreneurship, creative writing, film, and a whole bunch more. Skillshare offers creative classes designed for real life and all the circumstances that come with it. It's always the right time to stay inspired, express yourself, and connect with the community of millions. Right now, I'm checking out this course called Everyday Minimalism, and I'm trying my best not to buy a bunch of crap because, you know, online shopping is my vice and it's cluttering up my whole place. And who would have known that I could have gotten this on Skillshare, because they have been helping me out a whole bunch and it's dope. Explore your creativity and get 2 free months of premium membership at skillshare.com/brain. That's 2 whole months of unlimited access to thousands of classes for free. Get started and join today by heading to skillshare.com/brain. That's 2 free months of unlimited access to thousands of classes at skillshare.com/brain.
Like, I just,
yeah, it's for sure all young kids, right? Is that, yeah, is that what
and
you
he
feel?
Fucked a 13-year-old. Like, everybody just yeah. kind of glazes over.
He fucked
over.
His demographic.
I know.
Yeah,
I know.
He literally fucked like, his demographic.
You my demographic. I got to fuck you.
But it's like a cool thing to do it, right? Like, if you like him and shit. It's like cool. Because oh, it's like.
I'm different.
Yeah, I feel like, you know, there's going to.
I like the people.
It's cool to like him. It's cool to hate him. And
I think I think he gangbanged her too. I think it wasn't just
no.
One.
Yeah, that's what it was. I think it was like a whole group. And that's what I remember reading on it. I remember reading like something from the courthouse. Basically, what it was: this girl had a fake ID that said she was old enough. She came and she did a lot of stuff with a lot of people at the house, and that's what happened. I'm like, bro, but that what you said. I'm like, you should be able to tell a 13-year-old. I feel
100%.
Like,
yeah. I don't give a fuck.
Yeah, bro.
Tell what a 13-year-old fucking looks like. Like
hell
I said,
yeah, bro.
I guarantee you, she came in. She had some, I don't know, some knockers in her hair, yeah. And then she had that backpack. She had that sweaty backpack stain. Bro, yeah. You know what I'm saying? With the
probably
permission
had hot
slip.
Cheetos in her fucking purse or backpack
and her
and
fingers.
Shit.
She had a hot Cheetos on her fingers, and he was like, "That right there is an adult. I'm a fuck that adult."
Shit.
Pulls out her Hello Kitty wallet.
He's like, "Oh, she got Rugrat underwear on? Shit, that's mine."
And then people say, and the weird argument for that too, they go, "Oh, he's really intelligent. Oh, he's so intelligent he couldn't tell the difference between a 13 and 19.
He's not intelligent. He just knows how to talk shit. Yeah. It doesn't make you smart, bro.
I think he's just one of those people that just, you know, he just gets away with shit. That's what it is.
He had enough money to get away with some shit, but then that shit ended up biting him in his fucking ass. And at one point too, it was cool. It was probably cool to ride with him because he was blowing up so big.
If you
right?
piss
so
off
like,
a whole gang, dude.
Oh yeah, but that's like, what it is. Like you talked all that shit, but there's like actual people, actual gangbangers that don't play around with that shit.
Nah,
so like
bro.
It came to a point where you messed. I mean, you got a little too far with people that.
How
don't
come
play.
You never joined a gang?
You know what? You know what? I just wasn't cool enough, man.
They wouldn't allow you in.
I just wouldn't. You know,
they would allow you. You're like, "Hey, I want to roll with y'all." Shut the fuck up. I Dan.
I remember
he's like, "Word,
word,
like,
word."
I'll just keep the car running. In high school, there was a lot of guys that we used to hang out with that were all like kind of like bloods and stuff. But we were homies, but it wasn't like they definitely weren't asking me to do stuff with them because I was 5'3". And I weighed 100 pounds.
When? In high school?
Yeah, dude.
5'3"?
Damn,
bro.
Nah, bro. I was probably like
5'7". Grow a little bit, yeah?
Yeah, I'm like a 5'4".
I'm trying to picture you in a gang right now, dude. You definitely would have had a nickname with the ears or some shit.
Bro, yeah.
I don't know
bro.
What they would call you,
I could
you,
see him wearing a pro club with some like...
Bro, I used to wear Shockas and pro clubs all the time.
With that like straight up line up, like straight across.
Yeah, I had
and,
the
like,
fucking
the box,
picks and everything.
Bro, I
perfect,
see that shit.
Dude.
I could
but
see
But then
it.
I realized, I was like, you know what?
What's your gang member name then? ASAP Pocky.
ASAP Pocky.
Yeah, hey, those good. Those Pocky sticks.
Hell yeah, they're good. But you never had a Pocky before?
Nah, dude, I've been seeing them though. I didn't like. I was
He's
like
what are chocolate chip cookies? He's never had that
oh,
either.
Oh my god!
What's the matter with you, dude?
Hey, weird thing. I don't really. Fuck
name,
with
what's your gang
chip
member
cookies.
Name, dude?
I like ASAP Pocky.
Nah, you can't.
Hey,
they would call me. Yeah.
Think about a rap. What? This is what it is. You're a gang member, right?
Uh huh.
What's the crime that you did?
Little ear.
Okay, yeah. Little ear.
That's why, bro.
Little Dumbo. That's what people call me.
Little Dumbo.
How do you say ear in Spanish?
Oreja.
Oreja?
Yeah.
There you go.
All the little...
swear.
Yeah. Oreja. Oh, all the Mexican little cholos, they used to call me canas. Because I used to have white hair a lot of times. So I guess.
Hey,
you be
canas, dude.
Canas, fool. I got white hair. Like
canas?
No. Canas?
The whitest motherfucker.
Hey, you're talking Canas?
Is it C-A-N-A-S?
I think so.
Ooh,
with that
Canas.
N-A.
canas, bro.
Lil canas, bro.
Hey, canas, fool. What's up?
Mexican people love giving people nicknames that they never asked for.
Yeah. Chinito. They, like, obviously, right, they call cool. me Chinito.
No, the biggest one, bro. So, like, when I worked at Best Buy, right, the manager had a son, right? I think his name was, like, I don't want to say his name, but he had a name, a normal name, right? So, like, we call him, like, but his mom calls him Gordo, right?
Of course.
And I didn't know what that meant, but, like, a Gordo. Lot of people call people Gordo. And then, so finally, one of the guys, one of my friends there, Irving, he tells me, he's like, you know what Gordo means, right? I'm like, no. He's like, it's fat. I'm like, so we're literally just saying, hey, fat. Hey, what's up, fat?
Hey, fatty. Hey, fatty,
like,
fatty.
No, like, hey, what's up, fat?
Like, Mexican people do straight up, if Mexican people can attest to this shit. They give, it's not even like an offensive thing, dude. Though. They just give you, whatever you look like, that's the nickname that they give you, right?
Yeah.
Hey, fat.
Like, if you had a fucking wheelchair, they would just call you wheelchair your whole life. Even though there's
hey,
like,
roller, come
and,
here.
And then you kind of like how upfront they are about it.
Yeah. It doesn't matter if you're a paraplegic. It doesn't matter if you had a car accident and you almost died. Yeah. From now on, you're a wheelchair.
You're a wheelchair.
I just thought that shit was funny. Like, I was your wheels. Bro, so we just been saying, hey, what's up, fat? Hey, Gordo? Fat, come over here, bro.
The gay member of the family. Hey, Maricon, what's up? Hey, fucking cut that shit out, man. Like, relax. Maricon. We're in a new era, right? Fucking, he's good.
What would Dave's rap name be?
Huh?
Shit.
Guapo, baby.
No. That means you handsome, dog. You handsome.
Hey, Lil Walk. Because you like to walk so much, blood. Shit.
I don't
he's
mind
always
that
cooking,
shit.
Too.
Double entendre.
Oh, shit.
I love that shit, dude.
What was yours? I know you had a little gangbanger.
So my original rap name was Mooney, and this is why. Okay. Here's why. And it's M-O-O-N-Y.
You shaped like the moon.
Nah.
Oh, my bad.
Shit. Hey, no, so what happened was my brother used to be part of this little group in high school called GMK. And so, like, they had all the group, they had all their names, right? I remember a couple of them. There was one kid named, like, straight up, I think it was, like, Spider or some shit. And then the one that he still talks to that we know, his name's Gator. And then my brother's nickname was Sunshine. So the story was is
what? Why is he Sunshine? Well,
because
why are they Gator Spider and then hey, what's up, Sunshine?
Because
he was
you know those David sunflower seeds, Sunshine sunflower seeds.
Yeah,
we grew up always eating those, so that's why they gave him that nickname.
That's the hood snack.
I bet this boy ate the shell. You ate the shell,
nah, bro. What the hey, dude? I swear, he's hands on flying right now. What?
He's like, I smash cans on my head, but I don't eat the shells.
Hell no,
you fucking crazy.
So then basically what happened was is they met my middle brother Michael. And I guess they said that, all right, so they gave him the nickname Sunny Boy. And then so when they met me, the guy that gave me my nickname was like, all right, well, the sun's only out in two parts of the day. So you have to be like Moon. So he's like, we're going to call you Mooney. I was like, all right, cool. And I went with that forever. That was my rap name forever and stuff. But I never liked it. So then I got my new rap name called Lift God, because I used to know this kid named Matt that used to train at the gym. And like I always mess with him talking about partying and stuff. So I used to call him Lit God, LITGOD. And he was like, oh, well, you're the Lift God, like LIFT. So we always used to call each other that. So then when I was like, I'm going to start rapping again, I was like, oh, I'm just going to use that. I like that better. I can say
I like
it
Mooney better, way better.
Yeah,
I like
Mooney. Nah, fuck Mooney.
Guess you what? You should have never told us that shit. I'm calling you Mooney
and
all
first,
day.
My first nickname too, like in third, or no, when I went to, what was it, Lamos, whatever the hell the elementary school was. I think it was fourth, fifth grade. They used to call me Chunky.
Yeah, that's not even a nickname, bro.
Yeah, that's just
putting an adjective to the way you look.
They're just being, being fucking rude.
It was two black girls, Taria and Shimon. They used to call me Chunky, and that just everybody started calling me Chunky. I was like, damn, all right. I'm like, oh yeah, I like it. Go home and cry and shit. Chunky, blood, fuck, shit.
Children are fucked up, dude.
I know, dude. Hey,
what's up, Chunky?
They call you what they see. You
hey,
know?
Basically, that's Gordo, right? They were calling me Gordo. They just didn't know how to say that shit. They didn't know Spanish. Fuck.
You have a nickname in high school?
Nah. No.
Oh, you had nicknames, I'm sure, but they just never told you.
No, yeah, they call me the F word. They call me faggot. They call me faggot. Ooh, no, shit. But they would just, they would just call me my name. They call me Dunn. That was it. Something lame. Yeah.
They used to call you by your last name? Yeah. I never really got, only time I ever got called by my last name was like sports and shit.
They would call me, they would say Nick Dunn. They would always refer to me as both names. They would say,
I never got called David. I was always David So.
Yeah, everyone called me Nick Dunn.
So.
Oh, really?
I was never just David. It was always David So. Which is very odd.
Yeah, I only ever got called my last name like in sports, like in shit. But half of the time people say my last name wrong anyways, because it's one of those last names where it's like, so my last name is Acosta, but everybody says it Acosta, you know, that's how everybody says it. But so that's, I always got only called that in like.
That's the first time I ever heard you pronounce a Spanish word.
Yeah, acosta. Like you usually just slaughter it. Yeah. Why acosta now?
That's how I've always acosta. Said it from my family, has always said it that way. And it's weird because like, yeah.
But you're Gordo though. You Gordo.
I am Gordo acosta, papa. Hey, papa too. You got to put papa at the end. Up,
no. I like Mooney, bro.
Yeah, nah, Mooney's good. That shit.
Hey, I used to have this hat too that I remember I got it made. I thought it was so sick. It said Sky Crew on the front because that was like our little group, Sky Crew.
Damn, all you guys did in Arizona was sit around, think of nicknames and crew names the whole time. Dude. Hey man, what's gonna happen? Hey man, I saw you drop that orange yesterday, right? So I was like, oh man, your name is Dropped Orange, bro.
Hey, Drop Orange. Droppo. That should go hard, dude.
The way you guys came up with nicknames was very like detailed.
You wanna know how we got Sky Crew? So how we got Sky Crew was my friend Irving, who I used to work with at Best Buy, there used to be a club in Arizona called Sky. So they always used to go to it. And one time I was able to get in, I got snuck in, like, cause I was like 18, you had to be 21. So like we went, and then that was just like a thing. We used to be like, oh, Sky Crew. And then, so we started like a little group, Sky Crew, and it kind of just went from there. So
you know what's so funny? Crew. When you grow up in like these areas, and you always get these people around you that you grow up with that always come up with like the stupidest fucking like little cliques, bro. There was a little clique in high school called BYS, right?
And what the fuck is that?
You know what it stood for? What? I just knew them.
Bring your sluts.
Bro, I wish it was that. It would have been way better. They called themselves Be Yourself. Be Yourself. That's what it was.
Oh my God, I was like, bro,
are you fucking kidding me? I was like, that's what you guys came up with?
Yeah. We had that in school too. In high school, we had groups. There was one group called BOS, which is, I think it was, they stand for Boys of Summer or some shit like that, bro, dude. And they were all like the annoying ass, you know, fucking annoying ass kids, bro.
The things you think are cool back then, you know?
What the fuck, BOS?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then the other one, which we kind of hung out with kids from this group, but I was like, bro, don't ever call me that, bro. They were like, we're the Derps. I'm like, bro, get that shit away from me. Don't even put that name next to me. Oh, yeah. Bro. So all them smoke weed and shit. They're like, oh, we're the Derps. I'm like, y'all the
What
does
that
not
mean?
Weed, bro. Huh?
What does that mean? What does derps mean?
Like a derpy? I don't know. It's like smoking
terms.
Oh, yeah,
with a P.
D-E-R-P-S.
Oh, I thought you said derps.
Derps.
Yeah. No, derps.
Okay. Oh,
yeah, so I'm like, bro, dude, don't call me that shit. Yeah, but there, I remember
dumb as
that
fuck.
Was the thing, like a BOS and the derps. I'm like, bro.
That's the dumbest thing I ever heard in my life.
I
got
to move out there.
Well, let's talk about fucking, people been asking us to talk about this shit. I don't know why they want to hear MMA talk from us.
Oh, cannot wait.
Was it 249, was it?
Dude, this was one of the best fight cards from top to bottom. Let's start with Ngannou, bro. Let's talk about that.
You talking about the 20-second knockout?
I'm like, there's not that much to talk about, bro.
This is so funny. I remember watching it and they go, well, let's watch the replay. They're like, well, the replay is the whole fight.
They started the whole fight.
I know, right? They just play it all.
Yeah.
Dude, that shit's crazy. And what's crazy too, like when it first started, I was like, oh, this is going to be good. That full Biggie Boy landed some good ass low kicks. Those inside kicks, they were hard too.
But they didn't move him though.
No. Nope.
I know. And then, but I know like that second one, and Ngannou was like, no. And they start fucking swinging.
That's exactly
bro.
What he said. You know, like, today, motherfucker.
No, you go sleep. You go sleep now. And then just start fucking swinging on him. And those punches were so ugly, too. Yeah. Just swinging.
Well, if everybody goes, if you guys watch that and you guys look it back, Rozenstruik actually hit him first and just didn't phase him.
Yeah.
That's the same thing that happened with Overeem. Overeem connected this overhand on him, didn't do anything, and he just knocked his chin to another universe.
And Ngannou's head is fucking huge.
It looks huge, bro.
He has a giant, he has the head of like a panther or like a lion. That's how big his fucking head
is. And to your point, right? So the hook. Like, so as Ngannou's running in, Biggie Boy throws a hook, and it actually hits right on Ngannou's chin and does nothing. And to show you how...
Doesn't even move.
But show you how much of a chin he has, Andre Arlovski was, like, on a 7-fight, like, win streak, and he wasn't getting knocked out anymore. So that was his thing, because Andre Arlovski had a glass chin, and then it went away. He wasn't getting knocked out anymore. He fought Biggie Boy. Biggie Boy stepped back and threw that same little hook and knocked Andre Arlovski on his fucking ass.
Was he moving back when he
yeah,
knocked him out?
He was moving back. So the same thing with this, but this one landed better right on his chin, and Ngannou's like, no. And this kept going, bro.
No. It's also like when someone's pressing you like that, and you're in a firefight, and it's a guy like Ngannou, oh, bro.
This podcast is brought to you by Fiverr, my friends. Where do you go to find on-demand talent? How much will it cost? How can you be certain they'll deliver? Well, finding the right freelancer can be time-consuming, frustrating, and expensive. Trust me, I know. Fiverr's platform helps keep businesses moving with a network of trusted freelance talent. I love Fiverr. I use them for just about everything. If I want some straightforward freelance work with deadlines, straightforward pricing, and great communication, I go with them a lot of the times. I'm on a time crunch and I need stuff done, and usually I can find them on Fiverr. Trust me, guys, it's great. I seriously use it. I do. No joke. Fiverr is easy. You can find what you're looking for instantly. Search by service, deadline, price, reviews, and a whole bunch more. You'll know exactly what you're paying for up front. Amazing. No negotiating needed. 24/7 customer service. So check out Fiverr.com today and receive 10% off your first order by using my code GB. It's so easy. Find all the digital services you need in one place at Fiverr.com. Code GB. Again, that's Fiverr.com, code GB.
Dog, it was cool hearing all the punches,
one that
though.
Called for the fight, too. Yeah. He called out Francis.
Bad mistake.
Who the fuck would call out Francis Ngannou? I want to know that man.
Dude.
I want to have a conversation. Like, what were you thinking? I don't know. I don't know. He's from Africa.
In the interview, like, too. He was like, I'm going to knock his ass out and all the shit.
Oh, he legit said that he was going to knock out Francis Ngannou,
bro.
And Francis Ngannou was like, I'd like to see you try.
Yeah.
I want you to come here and then punch me in the face.
Tyrone Spong, I didn't realize Tyrone Spong walked out with him with a Rosenstrike.
Oh, really?
They're teammates. I think they're from the same country. They're from Suriname or something.
Bro, when Ngannou did the face off with Alistair, do you guys remember that? They were sitting there facing off and he goes, tomorrow you go to sleep.
That's it.
I was like, bro,
that's it.
And then he knocked his head into a fucking different galaxy, bro. That shit was crazy.
I think the only person that's going to be able to beat Ngannou is going to be a grappler, like a high-level
DC,
grappler.
DC, baby. That's probably the only guy. I think DC can give him some trouble, a little dirty boxing, some grappling.
But then he's so strong and so athletic, and like it's hard, bro. It's hard to imagine when you see a guy that dominant do that to a guy like Rosenstrike. It's hard to see him have any weaknesses as far as somebody going to take him down or shoot a double leg on
him.
But
this is what was happening before the Stipe fight. He was knocking everybody unconscious so fast. He fought Stipe's a good grappler, I would say.
Yeah.
He fought a good grappler and got outclassed.
Mm-hmm. And so he's now, big enough. He's tall enough, big enough.
So now he's doing the same thing. He's beating all these people. I think if he fights another grappler like DC or somebody, probably he's gonna get away. But I'm just getting nervous with that power, bro. I mean, like, especially DC, his teammate Kane, who DC used to say he could not beat Kane in a fight. I'm like, dude, he knocked his ass out too.
I thought Rosenstrike died. I literally thought he died.
He was slumped for like
his face when he was there, he's like,
no, bro, he was like just sleeping. Slumped over. Like, if you guys do a slow replay of it, his spirit comes out of his nose.
Yeah, bro.
Just starts looking. I told you not to, motherfucker. What did I say about that?
And what's crazy is we watched the slow-mo, and Ngannou's punch lands literally like
clean
on his chin.
Yeah.
And he was punching so wild. And then
he just started knocking the side of his head.
Dude, his accuracy, after he fell down, the first punch he throws lands straight on his face again. Yeah. I'm like, fuck.
And he's on top of him like, bah, 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 bah. That shit hurt my feelings.
I think he gave him a couple extra punches. Like, the ref actually had to come in and stop it. And you saw Ngannou felt bad for it, too.
Oh, no, he
went over there.
He was like,
oh, shit.
I think I killed him.
He's like, I threw extra. I am sorry.
I know.
Please forgive.
When you
were. Oh, he's Chinese now or what?
I know. Please forgive.
Pre-forgive. I'm like, oh, shit. Ngannou, what?
No, he knocked his ass out, though.
Dude.
Oh, did you guys think the Cruz fight was called off a little too early?
I think it was early.
No, 2 seconds left, and he couldn't let it go to 2 seconds on a championship fucking fight.
Did you hear Dominic Cruz talk about this? So Dominic Cruz, he had some words to say. And usually that fool, like, if something happens and he loses, he's very graceful in defeat for the most part.
Yeah.
And he accepts it for what it is. He takes full responsibility. But he said when he was talking to Keith Peterson, before the fight, like a rules meeting, they'll meet with them. The fighters will meet with the ref, and the ref will explain the rules, like what's illegal, what's legal for different states or whatever commission you're in. So Dominic says to him, he goes, hey, this is a championship fight. If something happens, let me go out. Let me go out. You don't need to stop it. Like, this is a championship fight. I'm here. I'm ready to die. So, like, if something happens, just don't stop it early. He literally says this to him. And then Dominic Cruz is saying, like, this guy wouldn't look at me during the rules meet, like, while he's talking to him, which is very odd. You know? And he just was like, hey, man, like, are you here with me? Like, talk to me.
He's like, pay attention,
like,
bro.
Like, I'm trying to tell you something. And then his corner and everybody was like kind of tripping out. Like, yo, what the fuck was that about? Like, that was kind of weird. And then Jeremy Stevens was saying, before I say that, Dominic Cruz was saying, like, this dude smelled like whiskey and fucking cigarettes. And then I guess Jeremy Stevens would tell him about stories about how they would all go out and they would have to take this fool back to his hotel all the time, Keith Peterson, the ref, because this fool would just get hammered.
Imagine how much that sucks, though, right? Imagine if that fool was drunk and he just couldn't, like, comprehend what was going on.
Or hungover or something.
Stops the fight early and just, not, that Dom doesn't only lose the title, but he loses half of the fucking money, right?
Yeah.
Because if you win, you get paid.
Exactly, dude. Exactly. It sucks. It sucks. And then I guess Dominic went up to him and was like, hey, man, like, there was 2 seconds left and I was getting up. And that these are the signs.
Getting up. Yeah.
These are the signs from, if I'm covering up and I'm not doing anything, that's a sign from the ref to stop the fight. But because he was working his way up and he was eating some like rabbit punches, which they look bad, obviously, right? Mm-hmm. But if he's working his way up and there's 2 seconds left in a championship fight,
you let that go.
You let that go. You have to let that
classic
go.
Classic example, the fucking Adesanya and
Kelvin Gastelum
fight.
Yeah. Amazing. And that one is a little extreme. Like, yeah, I feel
they
like
could have called that fight off stopped it. On that last round. He was dying. And they still didn't call it
exactly,
off.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. But when he got up to his feet and he told him, like, yo, why the fuck? Like, there's 2 seconds left. Mm-hmm. Keith Peterson says, it's not my job to know when the round is going to end. That is exactly your job.
Yeah. As a ref. What the fuck are you talking about?
That's crazy because you have to know exactly when to step in and break the guys apart, especially when the timer goes off.
Dom was saying something to him too when he was holding his hands before he wrote.
Yeah, he like pulled his arm off.
Yeah, but he was also saying something to Keith Peterson. You can see Keith Peterson just going, okay.
He wasn't looking at him.
Yeah. He was just looking straight. He looked red as a motherfucker, bro. Mm-hmm. I say this all the time. That fool looks like he'd be best friends with Bam Margera, bro. That's all I'm saying, bro.
He looks sketchy as hell. He has no shoulders, and he's all neck,
It's just
dude.
So fucking dumb, right? I mean, even just beyond the fight part, like you kind of, you took away from the fans who paid for the pay-per-view. Uh-huh. Like you have to think about it like that too. To a certain extent, I know your job is to protect the fighter, but he was getting up. He was going to the cage and he was standing up. I'm like, come on. And I'm a big Cruz fan
and
too, right?
And it's Dominic, bro. Like that's the style of the fight that
finished.
He has.
Yeah. He never gets finished.
He's always working. He's always moving. And he may get dropped every now and then, but he was very coherent. Like, you watched like
the interview after, he was so coherent.
When he got kneed, it did look like he was a little fucked up in slow motion, but he's making eye contact with Henry Cejudo the whole time and he's trying to work his way back up.
That's the thing. He was able to talk. He remembered everything.
Yeah.
All that shit. I mean, he remembers all this shit. It's like you knew he got fucked
up. And you could tell it was one of those like flash knockdowns. Sometimes when you get hit in the chin the right spot, your legs go out.
Yeah.
And that's what happened. And it's not like he wasn't aware of what happened, you know? And he has to understand like it's very easy for us to say, right? Especially if we're not in the ring and we're not in the cage as a ref. It's very hard because they have a really tough decision to make. But at the same time, it's like, dude, the 10-second timer went off. The pop, pop, pop. Dude. It went
you
off already.
Know, bro.
You know, and there was, it was a long, it feels like an eternity.
If that fool was fucking drunk during that shit, I'm going to be pissed.
That sucks, bro.
Or hungover or just not ready to go.
What sucks is I feel like they won't be able to tell if he was, right?
Because no one ever goes after the judges or the refs.
No. Dude, I would like to do that shit. I feel like that's something I would love to do.
You could
like be a ref or a judge,
you could probably do it. Just hit up Herb Dean.
I know.
He trains people, right?
Yeah, so at Fight Academy, they have a referee course. And like all the refs go through there. And dude, like you would be amazed at the people that just try it out. And like Herb will talk to us about it. He'd be like, dude, these people don't even know what arm bars are. They don't know. And they're trying to be a ref in the MMA.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
And he's like, dude, we got to weed these motherfuckers out. Like we have to teach them as much as we can as part of the ref course. But a lot of them don't pass because they think that it's just like, oh, I could be a ref. I could be an athletic commissioner.
It's just like these judges. Like, I feel like even for the MMA judges, right? I think there should be a certain requirement if you're going to judge a sport, especially when it comes to fighting, you have to train in that sport, end of story, because you don't know what you're looking at. Mm-hmm. You literally don't know, because I don't train jiu-jitsu. 50% of the time, I don't know what I'm looking at.
Yeah.
I just know
that
somebody's going to get choked out or they're going to get their arm snapped. So I can't really analyze it. And these people, too, they know less than I do. And
they're all boxing judges, too.
They're all Adelaide Burr, bro. That fucking chick.
Yeah. They're all boxing judges that came over. Yeah, that's something I think I would be good at, because I've been watching fighting for so fucking long.
You could for sure do it.
That I'm like, all right, I feel like I know what's going on. There's been so many times where, like, you know, some of the fucking cards and shit where or when they read off the judges' scorecards, I'm like, bro, what the fuck? Yeah. But there's so many times I'm like, all right, that's a 10-9. That's a 10-8.
It's different.
I'm
like,
dog. Oh yeah, let's talk about the scoring. There, which was the most
Michelle Waterson, bro? Yeah,
it was like weird.
30-27 from Michelle Waterson. Yeah, I was like, what the fuck?
I was like, I don't think so,
bro. They said that one first. That got her hopes up, bro.
Was that a split? It was a split,
right? So, which is fine, but it should have been no. There should have been no 10-27. Not in both sides. There shouldn't have been, because Carla Esparza got a 30-27 too.
Yeah, I thought she won two rounds. Yeah,
well, everybody has been talking about the scoring situation. Specifically, Joe Rogan has been very, very vocal about how they need to really get people who are experienced to judge these fights. Yeah. And because it's not just, it's like, oh, well, you know, they lost, but this is their livelihood.
Yeah, dude. Yeah.
And also too, like, I personally feel certain fighters, just from what I've seen, when they get that loss, it changes their mentality and their steam.
Yeah.
And especially when they know they've won a fucking fight.
It's such a momentum-based sport, dude. Like, inside the fight or after the fight, like, it's really hard to get that up and going again, because in the back of your mind as a fighter, it's like, dude, I'm putting everything into this fucking one fight, and I need to limit my amount of mistakes that I do inside the cage when I fight. But even if I do everything perfectly and I still lose because some other guy is not even looking at the fight, like, that's fucking crazy.
It also takes away from the legacy of the person who won the fight, too.
Yeah.
Because it's questionable.
Yeah, and now it's always but you only won, but.
Yeah, and there's no asterisks in this game, dude. Like, no one gets to say,
and honestly, for Henry Cejudo, too, I respect him a lot. You know, he's an amazing, amazing fucking athlete. But to be honest with you, I was there watching the Demetrius Johnson and Cejudo fight, and then afterwards I saw it again. I still don't think DJ lost that fight.
I think
a majority of people don't think he won that fight.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then you have the TJ Dillashaw, which everybody thought was an early stoppage. And now that you have this other one where it's an early stoppage, three of his championship fights kind of loses its credibility. Yeah. So you also take away from the fighter who wins. So it's just a really weird situation to be in.
The only one that he beat that I thought was going to annihilate him was Marlon Moraes.
Marlon Moraes
beat him up.
Yo, and that stoppage was a little late, because Marlon is fucking limp, dude.
Bro,
And Henry was just bashing his face.
Yeah, he beat him up, too. And I thought Marlon, which the first round he was
lighting his ass up,
bro.
And it was so crazy, because I really wanted to see what Cruz was going to do in that fight, because he was making adjustments.
Yeah.
And he was landing some good shots. And I just, like, as a fan of Dominic Cruz, I really wanted to see him.
He started landing to that jab cross.
He started a little slow, and he was finding his rhythm.
Mm-hmm.
And he knows it's a 5-round fight. I'll be good. You know what I mean? So
I know. I was like, hey, you good? I'm like, baby.
But Calvin Kattar, dude.
Oh, bro!
Fucking fight was
insane. I'm telling you, everybody's been sleeping on my boy Calvin Kattar.
His hands are so good, bro.
Jeremy Stephens, though, I gotta say, man, he had the great game plan. He came in and he started letting the sparks fly. Because usually,
when you watch Jeremy Stephens, I in my head, I'm always thinking, like, fuck, I hope he starts a little faster, because he's a little slow starter. And when he comes to the third round and the 3-round fight for Jeremy Stephens, he gives motherfuckers hell, dude.
Like the fucking scary fight.
Yeah,
bro.
And Zabit.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh shit, he's pouring it on. And Calvin looked a little uncomfortable in the first round. Yep. They started making adjustments. When Calvin landed that first right cross.
Oh, that shit.
Oh my God.
He ate that. Jeremy fucking ate that shit.
His head snapped all the way back, bro.
And for Calvin,
like, holy shit.
For Calvin Kattar to finish a guy like Jeremy Stephens, who never gets finished and who's always tough. In a 3-round fight, he's always there. He's always in someone's face, and he's fucking mean, dude. Yep. He's so mean. And for him to get finished like that, that's very impressive, dude. Nobody ever does that to Jeremy
Stephens. It's so weird how, I mean, I watch this fighting stuff, and it's literally a game of inches, because you can see Jeremy Stephens throwing that cross, and it's just
barely missing
this slow, barely missed it, and then he gets hit with that more precise elbow.
Yeah, dude.
And it's literally a game of centimeters and inches.
That cross landed, though.
Broke his nose.
Yeah, it broke. Yeah. So I loved that fight so much, I watched it about 5 times the day after.
Same.
And even that cross, the one cross he lands, I watched that punch.
He broke his nose,
maybe 15
times.
Yeah.
That shit was fucked up. Yeah.
So what happened was, on the last exchange, Kattar goes to throw the elbow. And as he's doing that, Jeremy throws like a punch, like across from here, like very short. and Cater's jumping in, that actually hits his nose. So as the elbow lands, because they show it in slow-mo, you see Cater come off to the side and stands up real quick and goes like this real quick. He touches his nose like super fast.
And then he starts
finishing. Gets down and hits him. And as he stops it, he gets up and immediately starts touching his nose. So what happened was that little short punch hit Cater right on his nose and broke his fucking nose.
If he didn't get hit with that elbow, like imagine how that fight would have changed.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, because that nose would have, that would probably fuck him up.
Dude, you really don't know how this
dude, but Jeremy Stevens is a fighter too. I don't give a fuck if he wins or loses. I just want to always see him fight.
Yeah, oh, I love watching him fight,
and
bro.
For as long as he's been fighting, he's still like so competitive in one of the toughest divisions in the UFC.
Mm-hmm. When he, like Josh Emmett, right? He was up and coming. He put that boy on his ass.
Yeah, and Josh Emmett's a fucking murderer, bro. Yeah. That fool hits like a truck.
And he hit him with that hook, too. That long ass hook. I was like, ooh.
His fucking name is Lil Heathen.
Lil Heathen dude. Stevens, bro. I always liked him, dude.
Even in the Aldo fight, he was fucking up Aldo,
he
dude.
He tagged him, right? He tagged him hard
before that.
A lot.
Fucking Aldo, the eviscerator body shot body that he got shot, him with.
Bro. That's fucking
Aldo. And you could see that Cater was trying to do those body shots, too, because he did land a couple of them.
And that body work was money.
Dude, that's what impressed me the most. I was telling Nick this in the car. It's like, those combos he's throwing, it's like shit that we do on mitts. Yeah. I'm like, I don't feel like I can land this in a fight. He was landing all of that shit, bro.
Calvin Cater's jab is so money because every time he finished hard with the right cross, touches with the jab, negates Jeremy Stevens from coming in, and it stopped him in his tracks and it messed with his rhythm. Once he started landing that jab, that's when he started.
What I realized he does a lot too, and I've seen people doing it, is like when he's just standing there, right, and they're like planning their exchanges, Cater just likes to throw, like, extends his arms out. Touch the hands, and then you don't know when it's actually coming, and then all of a sudden, bah, bah, bah. I was like, oh,
it's like a change
up. So nice, bro.
It's like, bah, bah, bah.
Yep, and he's just there, just,
Yeah, but what happened to your boy DeCastro, Mr. fucking DeCastro, bro, my boy?
DeCastro, if you watch this, my boy, you're gonna come back. I know this.
That fool fucking was. I've never screamed so much at my monitor in my life.
And everybody in the world was like, please knock him out. Dude. Everybody wanted Greg Hardy to get knocked
even
out.
Just, you know, it's not even the fact that Greg Hardy is just the heel of MMA, right?
Yeah.
It's the fact that DeCastro is way more skilled, way more precise, hits harder. He has everything that's better than Greg Hardy, and he gave up. Was so pissed. That first round, dude, he came in blazing.
He was looking so fucking up. Good,
the
bro.
Low kicks, the hands, everything was precise. He's a fucking technician. Remember somebody his size.
Yeah.
He's my height.
Yeah.
Dude, that text, remember I texted you my first round, I'm like, oh, fuck, bro, he's about to beat the shit. And then all of a sudden, I'm like, you know, you got to throw something, though. You know, the fucking round's still
second
going,
round,
bro.
Even before that toe break or whatever, right? Yeah. He was inactive.
Yeah.
He was inactive. Was like, he just stopped.
See, that's what happens when you get a guy that's like, he's, because DeCastro's relatively young in the sport. 6-0, 6-1 now.
Yeah.
And he was undefeated up until that fight. So it's, and I think a lot of his fights are first round KOs. Like he knocks fools dead. So once that passes for a lot of guys, they kind of lose their
like
wits,
they don't
about
know what
them.
To do.
Yeah, they kind of like, oh fuck, what do I do? And especially when you experience something like an injury in the middle of the fight, it's you never know how someone's gonna react. Yeah. So I think for him, it was like he's gonna be back. He's gonna
bro,
be fine.
He's clean. I'm
but
telling you, he should have won
that
fight.
Very
man.
Technical, but
should've won that fight.
It's like when you see someone like break their foot, and it's like fuck. And I'm sure that was the bulk of his game plan. So he's like, okay, what the fuck do I do?
Yeah, you could tell that was his game plan, was to be kick heavy, to break him down.
Dude,
so he
was
can
swinging
get in,
for the
his
fucking
reach was
fences.
His reach was 6.5 inches shorter. So I'm sure that was his game plan. Yeah. Let's mess up his leg so I'm able to get in and he can't run away fast, right?
Yeah.
But yeah,
Greg Hardy moves around a lot. He has
and Greg
movement.
Hardy said that he heard DC saying he needs to check these kicks or it's going to be a long night. And he's like, all right, watched it, and then checked it, and then broke that fool's foot.
He didn't really check the kick though. He was trying to move his foot away, and he just barely hit the tip. He didn't check shit, dude. He did not check shit. I'm not going to give Greg Hardy that much credit.
Nah,
by the way, Greg Hardy, if I meet you in person, I'm so sorry. Do not kick my ass.
Please don't beat us up.
Yeah.
Bro, now that Greg Hardy is not that. He's just, I feel like heavyweight is, I could be wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. I feel like heavyweight, if you want to use easy as a term, it's the easiest weight class to get into MMA because if you have a lot of power, you can win a lot of fights, right?
Yeah. Here's the thing about the heavyweight division for a lot of the times.
It's
and
not like, easy. Hold on, let me say. It's not easy, so I don't want everybody to go.
In most
it's not easy.
In most like combat sports, heavyweight has a like a there's no like middle tier guys. It's
yeah.
It seems like a lot of them are like really fucking up here. They win a lot, and there's other guys really that are shitty. Just kind of punching bags, and they kind of get beat up. But actually, I mean, skill wise, like yeah. the skills are very varying, right?
But you get what I'm saying.
They're
right?
not very. I guess you could say a lot of the guys aren't very well rounded.
You can't go to 145, 155, and be like, oh, I got a lot of power, so I'm about to be the fucking champ.
It's like no, you can't.
But I feel like heavyweight, because you are so heavy, and as long as you know how to throw, bro, if you land something, you know, it doesn't matter how big you are, you can knock someone out. And I feel like a lot.
If you were to watch the heavyweight division, there's very few guys where you could be like, oh, this guy's very technical and very like, oh, this guy's really good at what he
does. That's why Cain Velasquez was a fucking gem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for real.
So fucking dope.
Okay, what about the Fabricio Werdum fight versus the Oleneg fight?
Bro,
everybody, all the analysts were saying Oleneg is gonna get pieced up on the feet.
Me too.
Me too. I thought Werdum was like,
well, because he never throws anything.
Exactly.
His striking is the worst.
And Werdum's striking is pretty solid. Yeah. And Werdum looked kind of lost, man. Oleneg.
Well, Werdum has the same body as me with my shirt off. I was shocked. I was like, Castro,
DeCastro's me and David mixed together, bro.
Nah, but when you see DeCastro, you're like, that fool, he just a little fluffy, but that fool, he's a little muscly.
DeCastro could go down to light heavyweight easy.
Werdum just looked a little flat. Dude,
know what Werdum looked like to me? When they were showing, you know, like, how they're like previewing the fight and they're doing like the little shadow boxing and shit? I was watching it. I'm like, this guy looks old now.
He looked
like
he didn't want to be there, too.
He just looks old now. Yeah. He just looks old.
That little steroid helped him out a lot, man. Just his body looked ridiculous, man. I don't like watching a fight and saying, you know what? I could be in there. Like,
for real.
I want to see some fucking athletes, man. He looked really out of shape, very slow, and his conditioning was not that great.
And he hasn't been back in like what, like 2-3 years?
Yeah, well, his last fight, he got pieced up by Alexander Volkov.
Yeah.
Which
was fucking expected, to be honest with you.
Yeah, he pieced him up. Dude, Alexander Volkov's low-key real good, bro.
Yeah, he's very technical,
He just,
too.
I remember he was beating the shit out
people
of Derek Lewis.
People forget about him, man.
He got hit with, he beat Greg Hardy, which is
Volkov,
smart.
Is that his thing?
No,
he has
no.
Alexander Volkov's the 7-foot guy.
That Russian dude, blonde hair. Remember he fought Derek Lewis, and he threw that knee, the long knee on Derek Lewis?
Oh, yeah.
My balls was hot.
Yeah, no.
Oh, that was, right?
Yeah. He's real good. I think he's fighting Curtis Blaydes next.
Mm. Curtis Blaydes is good.
I think Curtis Blaydes can definitely be the champion. Once DC's out of there, I think, Francis Ngannou, bro.
Yeah, he's gonna be hard to beat, bro.
Yeah, bro.
He's gonna be so hard to stop.
Yeah,
I mean, Walt Harris is another good one, right?
And trust me, nobody wants to see Curtis Blaydes and Francis Ngannou number 3, where he gets knocked down in the first round again.
You know, I kind of like want to though, because
I don't want to see that again.
Did you guys watch the first fight? Like, Curtis Blaydes was actually doing good. He just got hit with the punch, and that was a doctor stoppage. It just swelled up too much. The doctor didn't
want
him to fight.
But that's what I'm saying. This is how hard he hits.
Yeah, I know. And he was doing good that one, and then the second fight. Yeah. Second fight, he just got finished. And I was like, fuck. I like Curtis Blaydes a lot, too. So I'm like, I always thought he was going to be the champ, but thinking about it right now, my dumbest, I'm like, oh yeah, once DC's there, but I'm like, oh, Francis Ngannou, he's already
Francis
yeah.
Ngannou
twice,
is just
bro.
Not human. Like, I'm pretty sure that he was a demon lord in some other realm, and he took the body of a man from Cameroon.
Yeah.
And then you have Francis.
I like when Joe Rogan explains his strength. He's like, just imagine digging sand and just digging. He's like, look at the strength.
That fool
you
is
get from
so
that.
Jacked.
He just started weight training like 6 years ago for the first time, and he looks like that. What the fuck?
He could be a bodybuilder, bro. He looks like Simeon Panda.
Dude,
much.
Those bros. That bros? Guy is big, bro. He's big, man. And
Simeon Panda's a large man. If you guys don't know who Simeon Panda, he's like UK, right? UK.
We were just talking about him before the podcast.
Yeah, he's a big dude.
And I asked him, I was like, you think this fool's natural, dog?
Simeon Panda ain't natural.
No, he claims natural, bro.
No fucking way.
I keep saying, bro, if you guys hear me say, because we watched fucking Max Holloway. And they say, bro, damn, bro, what's up, bro?
You gotta get Max Holloway on the podcast, bro. Reach out to him.
I would love to. Why is my fucking headphone out? Is that still recording? Yeah, it is, right? Is them things
bouncing?
Yeah,
it's recording.
Okay.
Why my shit go out? Did you unplug my shit, you
bitch? No, I swear I didn't.
Yeah, he did. It looks like it's sticking out, no? Oh shit! Yeah, that shit was big. Okay. Stuck out.
There we go. That was all
right. Yeah, but we was watching
Max Holloway on here, dude.
It's what it is.
It is.
When he talks, he's like, "You're stupid, bro. You suck, bro. You're trash, bro."
That's because he's lying. He's bitch and talk.
Yeah. So I keep saying, "Bro," and I'm like, "Fuck." I forgot what I was
saying.
We
always just say, "What it do, baby?"
But no, yeah.
What it do, baby?
The fights that are coming. Oh, so we didn't talk about the main event.
Which I mean, what's there to say about that, dude?
Literally, we have to, though, because I got to give my boy Justin a shout-out.
Nah, Ferguson's defense is fucking impenetrable. Did you see how many fucking punches he blocked with his face?
Bro.
That shit was tight, dude. He was like, you're going to punch here. I'm going to put my face right here.
Yeah, dude.
And I want you to get socked. Low-key, here's the weird thing, though. People don't understand this. And I got, you know, because sometimes I'd read these comments, right? Mm-hmm. You know, I understand Ferguson's a great fighter, but you have to understand, like, styles make the matchup, right?
Mm-hmm.
Gaethje is not somebody good for Ferguson.
No.
Ferguson had a way better chance defeating Khabib than he did fighting Gaethje because Gaethje's hands are amazing. He's an amazing striker. And you're acting as if Ferguson doesn't get hit in the face ever. He gets lit up.
Yeah. Pettis. And the thing about Ferguson is that his cardio is such a weapon.
Yeah, this is what you were saying earlier.
Where guys
it's true.
Don't think if I'm fighting Ferguson, I will always think in my head, I was like, this guy is never gonna go away. And that kind of like it freezes people up and Ferguson can kind of get away with it, right?
Yeah.
When he gets rocked or something, people dump the tank trying to finish him because they know they have to finish him now.
But you didn't see Gaethje do that.
Exactly.
Bro, I can't tell you. I was jumping out of my chair when he rocked him.
And he stuck.
I was watching my friend Patrick. I was like, please be calm, Justin. Please be calm. Yeah. Don't rush. And you see him just step back to the middle. I'm like, yes, dude.
And he knew, bro. He knew exactly what to do because on paper, Tony is a striker. Because he has so many ways to finish a fight, mm-hmm. he's always dangerous everywhere. But how he gets there is in the chaos. Yeah. And if he's not in the chaos, it's hard for him to kind of get off, obviously, right? Mm. But I will say Tony did look a little, to me.
I think for a lot of people.
When he walked in, I was like, he looks a little flat. Like he didn't look the normal Tony. Yeah.
You know where I felt that? Was in the face-off.
Yeah, on the walkout.
He didn't do no, whoo!
Yeah, he wasn't really like that amped.
I was telling you earlier what I think it was. I think it was there. I think what changed it all up, and if you go back to past interviews who fought Justin Gaethje, Gaethje started with leg kicks.
Yeah.
And if you listen to Eddie Alvarez and Dustin Poirier, his leg kicks, he fucking tore Dustin Poirier's quad.
Yeah.
He tore his quad. So I think what happened was he threw a couple of those leg kicks and Tony Ferguson's like, right, he's always kicking steel and doing all this weird shit. He felt one of those leg kicks and was like, oh my God.
Yeah.
Like that shit fucking hurt it. Yeah. That shit hurt it. Yeah. Right? So I think that's what slowed him down.
And
I think messed up his movement.
And also, Gaethje just didn't really, he didn't fade at all.
No.
And everyone knows that Gaethje has really good conditioning too. But it was also like, I think once Tony started throwing kind of the same patterns over and over again.
Oh yeah, bro.
Then Gaethje started reading. Like anytime you would throw a punch, single shot. Gaethje would come back.
Shout outs to Eddie Bravo, by the way, by that fucking random, hey man, you got to do an Imanari roll. Fuck Eddie Bravo. Yeah. What the hell was that?
And I think, you know what the other thing though too is in the corner, I feel like they all were just like.
They didn't know what to do.
They didn't know what to say because they're not used to seeing Tony that way.
They're used to seeing him beating the shit out of somebody.
And Tony seems like he's very self-motivated. And he doesn't
He's in
change.
Charge of his shit.
Yeah, he doesn't change how he fights for anybody.
Mm-mm.
And he really, I think he just didn't know what to expect.
Did you see that moment in the fight where he had like imaginary sand?
Oh,
and he
Hey, Justin even smiled when he did that shit.
You see that little Mortal Kombat low kick he hit him?
Yeah. Oh, dude, that was kind of cool,
that
though,
shit was kind of fire, dude.
Whoa. He did the Mortal Kombat sweep. I was like, how the fuck did he do
and he
that?
Landed that shit, bro. Yeah. I thought he was going to hit him. He's going to fall down. Tony, he hit him with that uppercut. He falls through the octagon and lands on the bikes and shit. Yeah. I'm like, fuck, bro. Like, this shit was crazy.
And Justin just like this.
Yeah.
It was a very weird. I mean, he cracked him with that uppercut,
bro. And the best thing about this fight, well, the whole fight card to me at least, was that the fact that there were no fans, so people could really appreciate how loud and how hard these motherfuckers are throwing at each other. And for Justin Gaethje to throw bombs at Tony Ferguson and for him to stay standing that way is fucking insane, dude.
Yeah.
And the way he took the shots, there was most of the shots I felt like Tony kind of was able to see them. Mm-hmm. He kind of rolled with it.
I feel like a lot of them hit like here.
Yeah.
His chest and his arms and
stuff.
But
the ones that like he didn't see, like he would kick and then he would, his body would be moving towards the punch.
Yeah.
And Justin would throw a full clip left hook at this fool's fucking chin. And he ate that shit.
And
incredible, dude.
DC had mentioned it too, and you could see, you could actually see it once DC mentioned it. He was like, Tony Ferguson's getting hit so much because, like, he's like, Tony will throw two and get hit with like three from Justin.
Yeah.
And it's happening so much that Tony's throwing stuff and just sitting there and waiting, because now in his head, he's like, all right, after these two punches, I'm going to get hit by three. So that's how like the rest of the fucking fight finished out.
He accepted it.
Yeah.
And that's the thing with Tony is like, his defense, like when Justin was on the defense, he was parrying all the shots.
Yeah.
He was addressing all the shots. And then his feet were always in good position. And that's something that Tony Ferguson, Trevor Whitman, his coach, which is an amazing coach, by the way, this dude was implanting with him, is just moving your feet, making sure your feet are always settled. And that's the fundamentals of like a good striker. And dude, what he did was like, it was a phenomenal performance.
Did you guys watch the embeddeds by chance at all?
Yeah.
So what I liked too, Trevor Whitman was having him do a drill where he was just kind of shuffling forward and back.
Yep.
And he was having him doing big. And he's like, all right, now shorten it. Yep. Think of it. Yep. Think of it as a wrestling. Think of it as this. And I was like, bro, dude. And his footwork looks so good.
And that's because for a guy like Justin, you know he's going to be a good striker. So it's like, okay, what can I make him do just to improve his base and help him the best way possible without changing his game too much?
Yep.
And it was his footwork. And that's what everybody, that's what all these really good, great coaches do with guys like
I mean, Justin, we still have to see how Gaethje deals with grappling, a grappling heavy fighter.
Exactly.
Because Khabib is on a different level. We could talk about grappling as much as you want.
Dog, all the guys at AKA, they're all like, dude, Khabib, you guys don't understand what a guy Khabib is. Like, everybody wants to say that.
And it's not even just the fact that he's from like Dagestan and what he does, because there are people from Dagestan in the UFC and they still don't grapple like
Khabib. Oh, hell no. Yeah, he's weird, unique. Right? He's unique. Weird, right? Yeah, like, because you hear that, like, oh, the Dagestan stuff. I'm like, they do not all of them, though.
Yeah, Khabib is like... The Dagestanis have a crazy culture of wrestling, and they do have a very high-level wrestling background.
Yeah.
But then you get a guy like Khabib, who could mix the MMA art into the wrestling is on a different level. The way he controls people and the way he transitions from position to position with strikes and submissions and is able to control people, he's a very intelligent fighter and he's so strong. And the way he fights is on a whole nother level. And people understand that. For you to be 28-0 in one of the craziest stacked UFC divisions and fought the killers.
Is insane.
Smoked everybody.
Yeah.
Dog, what he did to Connor, incredible. Like
crazy. RDA, what he did to RDA, RDA bro. That's when RDA all the
guys,
was good too.
All the guys that he fought were very different afterwards.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Very different.
And it's weird how people know his game plan and they still can't stop it.
Nope.
They can't stop it. And like Dustin Poirier had plenty of time to prepare for Khabib.
And Dustin Poirier, dude, is
amazing.
Amazing. Yeah. He's strong as fuck, amazing cardio, great hands. Pretty, and he's a high level jiu-jitsu guy.
Yeah,
like he's a
black belt, I believe.
Yeah, right? but even like people always talk about like in the circle, like dude, people don't know how good Dustin's ground game really is, and people always talk about that from high level grapplers, you know. And for him to go out there and just,
he almost did have that submission.
He did. But the way Khabib got out of that, I was like, what the fuck, dude?
Khabib also has no neck, and his head's the size of his torso.
His position is like his positioning is flawless, dude. Like it's. Khabib is on another level. And then once he starts fighting Justin Gaethje, who's primarily a striker, people have to worry about, people don't think about the transitions as a striker to grappling.
Mm.
It's so hard to deal with, you know, and like you look at Connor, the whole time, once Khabib shot that first takedown, he had to worry about the takedown the whole fight.
Yeah.
And look what happened. Would you ever put money on Khabib dropping Connor with a legit overhand?
Yeah.
Like, I think partially it was a little bit of a slip.
No.
But at the same time, he did get fucking clipped.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And the whole time he was worrying about the takedowns, he couldn't get his hands off, and that's going to change. And I wonder how Justin is going to be able to deal with that.
I personally think Justin's, out of all the fighters Khabib has fought, Justin's going to be the one, like Ally Quinta, that's going to be able to get up.
See,
I think he's going to.
I think so too, but also Khabib fights the level of like the fighter that he's fighting, right? A guy like Ally Quinta, no disrespect to him, but I just feel like Khabib took the foot off the gas a little bit. And he was like, you know, I'm going to stand with this fool. Like, I'm gonna strike with this dude.
I think Justin has about two rounds to get Khabib out of there.
Yeah.
And if he doesn't, I think it's going to be.
If anybody looked at that Ally Aquinta fight and they think that Khabib was going 100% on him, you're fucking lying to yourself.
He, also, that he change of opponent. Yeah, but there's also a change of opponent like four times for that fight. It was Max, and then it was supposed to be Anthony Pettis, and then it was supposed to be Paul Felder. And then it was Ally Aquinta. But I think Justin, from wrestling and from hearing about people from wrestling from him, I think he's going to be able to get up a couple times.
He is a highly decorated wrestler.
Yeah, I think he's going to be able to get up a couple times, and that's going to be dangerous because I think in the past couple fights, Khabib has gotten hit.
Yeah.
Well, I think Michael Johnson lit him up a bit pretty hard too.
Yeah.
And I don't think Justin's obviously not scared of it. I don't think anybody's scared of anybody, but I mean, he really doesn't give a shit. So he's not going
to.
He's just going to just go forward and start throwing those fucking punches if he gets up.
I always wonder too, when somebody meets Justin in a cage, just like people don't know how high level Khabib's wrestling is, they don't know what it's like to get hit by Justin.
Yeah, dude. Those leg kicks. Bro, imagine those leg kicks, bro.
Because if he gets those off. See, that's the thing. It's like a lot of the times the paradigm in MMA, like especially early on, was like never kick a wrestler, never low kick a wrestler. Mm. Right. So it's but a guy like Justin, he hits off rhythm. He has like weird setups for his low kicks.
It's exactly what DC said.
Yeah. People know that Justin's going to low kick, but they can't time it.
No,
he throws it. He throws a lot of change ups and he's very methodical when he throws a low kick. So that it plays a different factor with a guy like Khabib.
The fight with Edson Barboza, one of the scariest kickers, right? Has the fucking
outlaw kick that guy, dude.
First thing he does is start throwing low kicks on Edson Barboza. He's like, I don't give a fuck.
I remember when I watched that fight, I was like, oh no.
Also, too, like it seems like Justin Gaethje too has a higher pain threshold for pain than everybody else.
Yeah.
Because you could hit him pretty hard too, but he could take it way better than you can. So he's just a really difficult guy to deal with, right? His hands are amazing.
Yeah.
His positioning is always great. You could hit him hard, but he could also take your fucking hit. He's been hit with everything.
Dog. So there's a fight that everybody should watch. It's this guy named Luis Palomino, who's the guy from Florida. He's like infamous in the MMA community. Like this dude is scary as fuck. One of the homies, Diego, used to train with that fool. Mm. And he would tell me stories about training with that guy. He's a complete fucking savage. And he looks scary as fuck, you know, like jacked. And he has a really violent fighting style. When he fought Justin Gaethje, it was like 15, it's like 17 minutes long is the clip. I don't know how long the fight was.
Is this
was.
The dude that he was low kicking the living shit out of?
Bro.
And I remember he low kicked him and then his legs buckled and he just kind of fell over.
He went straight.
He just leaned
off. This is one of the most violent fights you could ever watch.
Yeah.
And it shows how, like, what a savage Justin Gaethje and Palomino is for fighting this dude.
Well, Trevor Whitman says, he's like, I've trained a lot of people. He was like, Justin Gaethje actually has that mindset where he's like, I'll die in there. Yeah. I don't care. He says Justin Gaethje, and Justin says it, he's like, he doesn't care if he wins or loses. Yeah. It doesn't matter to him if he loses.
He is literally saying, I have so much fun in there.
Yeah.
And that's scary, dude.
Yeah. Dude, in the middle of the round, when he starts, I think before the fifth round, and they go to the corner, he's laughing. Oh, that's fun.
Yeah.
You're like, what?
And then
Trevor
Whitman literally has to be like, hey, dude, remember what happened when you had too much fun the last time?
Yeah.
He goes, you got knocked out. And he goes, twice.
Yeah, I know. Dude.
Which is one of the coolest like exchanges from coach to a fighter in the middle of a fight.
Yeah,
that was one of the gems of the fight, and that's why I love it when there's no audience because you could hear all those things.
And this is why I like no audience too, because I feel like we talked about this before. Mm-hmm. Audience can either really help a fighter or it can really fuck up a fighter. Yeah,
the boos.
Yeah, the boos are the things, right? It can really help or fuck up a fighter. So I like it because I'm like, they don't have that. So now you get skill versus skill. There's no extra thing amping someone up or deteriorating their confidence or anything like that. I also think two fighters fighting each other. That's it.
It's also because the crowd also makes the ref interfere unnecessarily.
Of course. Yeah.
Which is
and
so
judges
annoying.
Too.
Stand up the fight. Yep.
And
yep.
judges yep. too.
I hate it when they stand up a fight when they're working, dude. It's like they're working. This person has fucking position. Let them have it. They
worked so hard to get it.
Yeah. And then stand up. Like, what the fuck? I'd be so pissed.
And that's new for like, I feel like a lot of new fans. Because when I first started watching UFC, I must have been like in fucking fourth grade or third grade. I don't truly remember. I just remember used to staying up summer nights. It was on Spike TV. They used to, UFC Unleashed. They used to show it on Spike TV, right? Yeah. So I always used to stay UFC up late Unleashed, and watch those because I'm like, oh, this is cool. You know, I never see them. It's like, you want to see that. You don't, when I was first watching it, you don't really know what's going on. So when you see those people holding or just laying on the floor, you're like, oh, stand them up. But as you start watching, you're like, no, don't stand them up, fool. They're still doing shit,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And but you have fans there that are probably like me when I first started watching, or a lot of people are still new to it. They're just like, oh, let's go see some fights. They're there, and then it's boo, boo. Yeah. When I went to the Bellator fight, dude, we were watching the fight, and that shit was happening. People were booing and shit.
We were
literally saying all out of my, I bet you any, all these people don't know shit about MMA.
Yeah.
They're sitting here booing.
Well, most people, man, so the Cody Garbrandt and the TJ Dillashaw and the Cejudo
Mighty Mouse
fight, right? That's the first time I ever went to a UFC event. I was on the ground floor next to the cage and maybe 10 seats back. I will never ever go watch a UFC fight live ever again. It is way better just watching it at home.
Oh, hell yeah.
Because you can't see.
You can't see anything. Mm-hmm. And then number two, you realize a lot of these people who buy the tickets for UFC actually don't like fighting. They just like the animalistic
going there.
You know, just watching somebody crack somebody's face.
And it's like a status thing
and
for
all
those
people. And you hear the conversations of everybody who's watching it, right? And you could tell they don't give a shit about the sport. Like there was this guy. He brought his date over, sitting next to us. He had a little nice little fucking sweater around his neck and everything. Ooh. Like that. You
know,
that
was it Gucci?
It was Gucci.
Oh, shit.
And he brought his date over. And clearly, he bought these nice seats for her to impress her. And he's literally talking the most dumb shit I've ever heard in my life. And he's talking to this girl. And he clearly brought her over there because she loves MMA.
Yeah.
And even then, she was getting annoyed by the shit that he was saying. He goes, dude, just choke him out. Why can't he just choke him out? Yeah, and she's sitting there just like, You know, you can tell she's being a little irritated.
It's like that meme. It's like a guy, there's a meme that's going around right now, and this dude looks like a total douchebag, and he's talking to this girl, and he's like, hey, babe, that's Conor McGregor. He knocked out Chuck Lesnar.
He's like, my name's Chad, by the way.
I forgot what fight he was watching on that card, but he just kept screaming, rear naked choke. I'm like,
they're standing up. Rear naked choke.
Not even fucking lying. They're standing up.
Oh my God.
And I'm looking at this guy. I'm going to sock this fool. You're ruining the moment or the experience for me, bro. Shut the fuck up.
I can't tell you how many times I'm like, you know what? I'm going to go to the fights. And as it gets closer, I'm I don't want to buy the ticket.
It's way better watching it at home.
It is because, you know, I feel like we're a sport, too, that has good commentators like Joe Rogan, DC, and stuff.
I want
to
hear it.
I want to hear what they're saying. And if you go to a fight, you can't hear it.
Oh, that was another thing about the fight, too. It was so cool watching all three of those guys, John Anik, Joe Rogan, Daniel Cormier, like just interact throughout the night. Like, because they're so amped to be there and they're just having fun, bro. DC and Joe Rogan together, they're dynamic. Is amazing.
He needs to stay as a commentator
forever.
It's gonna be so weird.
I'm sure he's going to. You mean Joe or DC?
DC and Joe.
Oh yeah, all of them. Yeah, I know. DC's gonna be there for a long time. Yeah. Joe, I don't know. You know, he's been doing it for so fucking long.
I love the posts after all the fights are over and they just talk about everything.
Yeah,
it's so cool watching all those guys interact, man. Mm-hmm. Like I could sit there and watch them talk forever.
Like my dream job right there. Just to be able to talk. I would as like fights are going on.
It would be great if they could just bring fighters to be judges. Yeah. Right. Because look at how much they can analyze what's going on.
They're starting to do that.
They have to. They literally have to.
But the problem is that these are like state run commissions. So for them to kind of like a lot more fighters are able to get into like refs. Like Frank Trigg is a ref.
He's a ref.
What's his name? The guy that fought. Chris Lieben is a ref now.
Chris Lieben is a ref.
Yeah, he's a ref for California.
Yeah.
He refed one of my homies. Frank Trigg reffed one of my homies' fights. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Chris Lieben was crazy on the contender or whatever.
Oh, yeah. The ultimate fighter.
He was good for a minute, too, dude. He was good. Knocking people out.
He's just a tough motherfucker, bro.
I mean, he was knocking people out because he was Korean Zombie before Korean Zombie.
Yeah.
He was just he was supposed to be knocked out. He just kept
swinging. What's that fight happening? Korean Zombie and Brian Ortega.
Oh, man. Oh. I can't wait for dude, that one, dude.
Crazy I'm a huge fight. Korean Zombie.
Formal
fan.
Apology too, to Jay Park, just to put it out there. We were making assumptions, right?
Yeah.
And it was so funny. People were so mad.
People got really mad. But we were just speculating, dude.
We said in the podcast, we're speculating. We don't know.
Dog, we know he shouldn't have slapped Jay Park.
We're just saying, like, what
it's,
if?
Yeah, dude, it's a fun conversation. Come on, yeah, dude.
And you plus know how many people, skin looks so soft.
What else, yeah, too, have dude. People been correcting a lot is, you know how I say slaps for everything?
Oh, yeah.
Everybody's like, it smacks. I'm like, bro, there's not a fucking rule. I can say slaps,
yeah,
for food
can
if
say
I
where
want
the fuck
to.
You want.
It's because it's a Bay Area thing, right? So I know, yeah,
they
you've
take
been
their
saying,
lingo very
I
seriously.
I mean, you've been, it's for some reason, people in the Bay are so particular about that shit. I'm from Sacramento, right? So, like, I understand what they mean, but it's a big fucking deal. Who the fuck cares?
I'm like, bro.
Right?
I've just said slaps for everything. I never knew it was like a term in the Bay.
Yo, when
I didn't
fucking
know.
Alex fucks, like, yo, this pussy slaps.
Hey, I know. I'm like, hey, girl, this pussy really does slap on it.
She's like, excuse me, you're supposed to say smack.
Yeah, it
I'm
smacks.
Like, oh, shit, dude. All right, bye.
Yeah, but Bay Area are very, on his head, they're, you know, very fucking particular about that shit. They want people to understand that when it comes for food, it smacks. And then when it comes for music, it's always slaps. But you don't use it for anything else. And if you do, it's heresy.
Hey, I'm gonna use it for both. I don't say schmacks.
Yeah,
I don't do that. I say slaps for everything.
It's not as fun to say.
But I'm just. Well, I guess my thing is, I guess people in SoCal or whatever use it different. That's all.
Yeah,
it is what it is.
Whatever, bro.
Dude, who cares?
What a weird thing to like get upset about. I don't think they're upset, but just like, you know,
that shit schmacks.
Yeah, and it's slaps. See, that sounds weird. I don't want to go I don't like that shit. Because all this like fucking
say.
All the like gunk builds up and like you drip and shit, bro. I ain't trying to drip.
Oh, shout out!
I mean,
to,
I got drip, but
shout outs to fucking Alien Beef Jerky for the racist eat. Yo, you guys want to hear something mad funny about that shit though? I'm not saying that I am the catalyst or the source for that shit.
He's the catalyst. He's the source.
No. David's not saying.
No,
it.
I'm not saying I'm the catalyst. So I got a message from a friend of mine, who told me about. His personal friend that contacted this is a really famous beef jerky spot that everybody stops by when they drive to Vegas, right? So that long 3-hour drive, everybody stops by that spot. Even I know that place. They have really great
everybody
beef jerky.
Knows that.
Even I do. I've been to Vegas once, I think.
And they, you know about that spot, right? Very unique. The beef jerky's, you know, really good. Mm-hmm. It's an immigrant Mexican family that owns it. So one of our friends, she basically emailed them. I don't know exactly what she does, but, you know, it was solicit them for some business or whatever, right? And he responds back that we don't – not the exact quotes, but basically saying that he doesn't want anything to do with any Orientals. Delete my email or whatever, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
And so people's
– It was very aggressive.
It was very aggressive.
For a business email.
Yeah. And so she was like, what the fuck?
Did she – in the email that she sent out, did she say that she was an Oriental?
Well, her picture is there on the email. So he saw the gooky ass eyes. He goes, I don't fuck with gooks.
There it is, dude.
And
what
so,
else do you have to say?
I don't say that word.
A buddy of mine messaged that to me, and he's like, yo, what the fuck is this shit about? He goes like, yo, can you do something about this? And at first, like, I don't really like doing this, but then I kind of sat on it and I'm like,
it's problematic, dude.
I was like, this is fucked up.
Yeah, that's
you know.
Up,
so I did a little light tweet. The tweet's gone now, by the way. I deleted that shit. That shit was getting a little too crazy.
Doesn't matter.
I screenshotted it. I'm the king of screenshots. You should know this.
DM Alex for that.
It was
screenshot.
Kind of getting up there in likes and retweets a little faster than I expected. And I'm like, okay, well, they learned their lesson, because after I posted that, about an hour later, they had like, I don't on their Yelp, because I actually hyperlinked their Yelp as well.
Yeah.
It got, I don't know, 200 like 1-star reviews in like an hour or something. I'm like, cool, they learned their lesson, nothing is gonna happen after this. Lo and behold, that day it's everywhere, dude. Like it blew the fuck up.
Well, that's what you kind of deserve though, you know. Talking
for,
like that, what
for,
the fuck
for what that per- and then their excuse was kind of weak. They said like he's a Mexican immigrant.
That has nothing to do with the email.
The language barrier. But I was like, dog, this fool's been and then people were also saying that they've been in business for like 23 years.
Yeah.
They
and they
exactly
they
were dealt with all Oriental
and
people
they were
and,
also,
shit,
and they were also saying that this is like they've done stuff like this before. Oh, he's not supposed to be making those messages. Like,
yeah,
he's not the one in charge. So,
so who the fuck gave the email password then? What the hell?
So then that's even crazier.
So he came up to one of his kids. He's like, hey, let me see the password.
He's like,
I'll
handle this. Yeah.
I just need to buy something from Amazon. Let me
you know what that password. Reminds me of now? Actually, something like that kind of happened in the powerlifting world. There is a big meet that always goes on, and it's one of the meets where like the big lifters go because you can make a lot of money off of this meet. I forget the exact name of the meet, but it was held in a gym in San Diego, right? So they open up, like, I do this meet called the Boss of Bosses. It's at a gym in Mountain View. You might know where that's at, right?
Yeah.
Mountain View. It's owned by a guy, a big powerlifter named Dan Green. He owns the gym, right?
That so man looks like a refrigerator.
Oh, you know who Dan Green is?
I know.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so... Yeah, so he holds that meat, right? So I do that one. So there's another meat like that, really big. They open it up at Bosses. They do one day where it's like amateur, you would say, and then the other day's professional, or like you don't have to qualify for this day, but if you're going to do this day, you have to qualify, right? So same with this other meet. They did something like that where you have to qualify for this meet. So this one girl emails the meet director who owns the gym her numbers and stuff like that. Like, oh, this is my numbers, la la la. Basically, she qualified for the meet or some shit like that, right? The response back from that girl was like, why the fuck are you like wasting my time with this bullshit, with these weak ass numbers, like saying some fucking crazy ass shit, right? So that girl screenshotted it and posted it on Instagram, and everybody just repost. It got all the way back around to the federation that we, like, I compete in, USPA. And they actually like wiped her off. She's not allowed to hold the meets anymore. That meat got wiped.
So why did she? Why did she go off like that?
I don't fully remember what her excuse was. I think she was like, she was emotional or that type of some bullshit.
Yeah,
bro. Like, that was the thing. She was like, the girl was like,
cop out.
The girl was like, you told us to email you our numbers and stuff. That's exactly what I did.
Yeah.
And her response, I don't remember word for word, but it's like, what am I supposed to do with these weak ass shit? I was like,
first of all, it's money, dog. I'm paying you.
All you do is just be like, sorry. This highly still competitive. This still doesn't meet the requirements that we're looking for the competition.
First of all, I just want to say this. Stuff. What a great roast, though. Hilarious. But second of all, like,
why would these weak ass fucking bitch ass numbers?
Because if I was somebody who was a weightlifter and I heard that, I think I would cry.
Yeah, I'd quit.
Yeah. And second of all,
fuck me, right?
People get emotional about their numbers and their calves, too. Yeah. Don't forget them calves, bro.
Hey, I don't know what that's like, because your boy got great calves.
I know, me too.
He's talking about me.
Yeah,
right?
Those little fucking you got nothing, bro. So fragile and weak, bro. I sometimes want to crush you and just be like, bro, like, get bigger.
Fuck, dude, I'm trying, man.
It's all good.
I'm waiting for my steroids in the fucking mail. This guy's gonna get me on a cycle, dog.
Hey, them shit's fun. Hey, don't say that. Everybody think I sell shit, bro. I don't.
Hey, yo, DM this fool for your steroids. God, we got SARMs. We got HGH.
We got SARMs. HGH.
We got all the
HG
stuff.
SARMs, dude. You don't even know about that shit, do you, huh?
Yeah, homie.
We got Dragon steroids, bro.
Yeah, dog. Bro. You want scales?
No. Yeah, no, it's crazy. Steroids are crazy too.
Let me tell you something. If you guys ever see me buff ever, just know that I was on steroids. Yeah. There's absolutely no way I did that by myself.
Me and David are gonna hop on a cycle together.
Nah, man, I feel like I would get the bad end of it. We're not doing that.
You wouldn't, bro, because that's how I was. So I did a cycle of test, right? And that's kind of how I always was. I was always so nervous to do it.
Well, are you admitting to steroids right now?
Yeah, I don't care, bro. Wow. I don't understand why people lie about this shit, dude. It's like, I feel bad for like people that are trying to come up in, like, say you're trying to learn fitness and stuff, and you see this person and they're like all ripped and shit and they're lying. They're like, oh, I'm all natural.
Dude, that's the problem with a lot of people who kind of, well, here's the thing about the fitness industry that a lot of people don't know. So much money in this shit. Like, a ridiculous amount. There's a reason why people are posting up these photos and everything else like that. And at the end of the day, when it comes to promoting yourself, especially when it comes to fitness, a majority of people don't understand, and not just fitness, just things in general that are very specialized. Most people don't care about the specificities that allow you to be to have great credentials in whatever you're doing, right? For example, like, Nick could be, what are your credentials?
I have a CSCS and I have a bachelor's in science of in.
That's right. He's LGBTQ, right?
Yeah.
And I'm a nutrition coach. That's precision his credentials. Nutrition. When you read that on a piece of paper, right, it should look very impressive. Mm-hmm. But people don't give a fuck about that. What they do, they look at somebody, they go, "Where's your six pack?"
Yeah.
That person with the six pack too, you don't exactly know how he got it, if he's genetically gifted or not. Mm. It doesn't really show that somebody knows what they're doing, specifically when it comes to fitness. And the reason why people do steroids and they don't want to tell you is because a lot of people are laymen, such as myself prior, and I would look at somebody and go, "You know what? I don't care about the stats. I want to see what you look like."
Yeah.
And so
yeah.
they take steroids and they sell these programs and they go, "Guess what? You can look like me within 3 months. Yeah. I guarantee it." Yeah. If you take the roids along with it, though.
I see it all the time,
We see it all the time,
dude,
because
it's dishonest.
We work with people that are coaches, because we're both coaches. We're private trainers. And we've worked with people, whether it's boxing or Muay Thai or strength conditioning and powerlifting. We see so many different people that have no business coaching clients or giving fitness advice. Because it's not regulated. A lot of people,
blood, it drips.
Exactly. A lot, yeah, fuck. There's a lot of people. There's a lot of people that can go out and get a weekend certification and then just say, hey, I'm certified.
A lot of this shit too, you can just do online.
Exactly.
You don't even have to go face to face with anybody. You can go get your cert.
So I'm gonna tell a quick story. There's a guy that we train with at my gym, and I probably shouldn't say this, but I'm gonna say it anyway, because he's a dickhead. And this guy has a lot of like older clients, and he tells them nonsense. The shit that comes out of this guy's mouth is fucking, he should be in jail, dude. And shout out to the homie Dan, because we listen to this all the time and we always look at each other. Saldana Fitness, my guy. And he always telling me these stories about how this guy saying, oh, you know, he'll go to a client and he'll like rub them out, roll them out, and he'll tell them, oh, you know why your legs are sore is because your IT band is so tight that by the time the blood flow is little droplets right here. So by the time the blood drips all the way down to your calves, there's no blood. So that's why you're so sore. If you, I don't care if you're a doctor,
what the fuck, dog?
And some of these people that don't know if he's right or not, it's not their fault, right?
Because they don't know any better.
Exactly.
No. You're taking advantage of it.
As a fitness professional, you're going around saying this to. And he has a lot of clients. He's saying this to a lot of people.
Yeah.
Dog, what the fuck is going on, bro?
It's the same concept. They're literally taking advantage of somebody else's ignorance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's what happens. And that's why a lot of people, too, they get disappointed in their results.
Yeah.
It's so difficult. I had another buddy of mine who started doing macro fitness and nutrition, right? And he set up a really great program for a lot of people. The reason why he stopped doing this business wasn't because it wasn't what he offered wasn't doing well. He started getting depressed and sad because he kept on getting people, clients, and he would help them out, right? Get them on their macronutrition. It's been a year. They lose like 30, 40 pounds. They look great.
Yeah.
And they go, well, you kind of failed me because I don't look like this guy. And he's like, what do you mean? He's like, we've been doing really well. You look great. He goes, yeah, but these other programs, they say I can get ripped in 4 months.
And it's like, run for the hills, dude.
He goes, fuck. Well, and he just kept on getting this back over and over and over again. He goes, I'm done with the fitness industry. I don't want to do this anymore.
It's soul draining sometimes.
Did he have like a food prep company or no?
No, he worked with people. Online nutrition stuff. And he programmed for them as well. Mm. And at the end of the day, people weren't, and he got really ripped. Yeah. Right,
he's jacked, bro.
He got really jacked. City. It took him like a couple of years, though.
People don't understand that shit. People want shit so fast, and it's the same thing. Like, kind of like what you did is what people aren't willing to do is go look and do research when you find somebody to coach. And I always tell people this too in powerlifting world because I see it all the time. Just because someone's strong doesn't mean they know what they're doing. Exactly, doesn't mean they know how to coach. I can't tell you
how much
strong people I know that. And that are coaches, and like I see people in and out of our gym that have these programs of different like top coaches or just people that are through the gym that are strong, and I'm seeing what they're doing. I'm like, what the fuck are you doing? And you already know it's bad. Like, cause I can't tell you how many times I've had athletes at the gym that I train at, Mission Fitness Center, right, that come in and they ask me, hey, do you think I should be doing this? I'm like, if you're questioning what your fucking coach is doing, you obviously know that it's not fucking right, right? Yeah. And they still stay with these people just because it's like the cool thing. Oh, my coach does this. My coach does that.
He pulls this.
Like, I mean, it could be the same shit for fighting, right? Just because you're a good fighter doesn't mean you're going to be a good coach.
We know some motherfuckers have no business
coaching
motherfuckers. Bro. And the shit that they have their clients doing, and they give them, it's one thing if you're doing fitness boxing and you just want to hit, that's one thing. And that's totally understandable. But if you're trying to provide someone with the skills and knowledge that, oh yeah, you could be able to fight one day, and you're teaching them some of the shit that we've seen.
Yeah.
It's fucking, oh dude.
Shout out to Gloveworks, baby.
Bro, no, there's some people, dude. That shit's
Gloveworks, baby.
We got to get Chris Sosa on here to talk about that shit.
It's fucking crazy, dude. It's some of the shit. Yeah, I could blow up a bunch of people right now, but I'm not going to.
It's fine, right? Yeah. But it's at the same time.
I just want to know, how do you, as an individual, as a human being, take somebody's money and then have them walk away with nothing?
Exactly.
You are stealing from them. And on top of that, too, I think when it comes to fitness and people who really do want to get fit and they're in a bad place, they're coming to you because they trust you. Yeah. They trust your knowledge. And this, it's a lot for somebody to come up and, you know, to ask for personal training, ask for guidance, and you give them fucking nothing, and they get no results, yeah. and they go back home and they blame it on themselves. They go, "Well, yeah. it's clearly not my trainer because my trainer knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
I'm the one that's dumb here.
I'm fucking up.
I had experienced that at our old gym, at our first location. We had this trainer in there, and he was one of those trainers where he would tell like his athletes or, excuse me, clients like all this weird shit. I remember this one day and. The client wasn't there, so I like when I say this, it's kind of like I sound like an asshole, right? But the client wasn't there. He had just finished training this person, and they leave, right? And he comes, and they're looking at these pictures, and I walk by. He's like, "Alex, look at these pictures, right?" He's like, "This is today. This is 2 weeks ago." He's like, "Look, don't you see a huge difference?" And I look at him, I'm like, "No."
For real, dude.
And he's like, "What do you mean?" I'm like, "Oh," I'm like, "is there supposed to be like a big difference? They look exactly the same."
Yeah.
He's like, "Ah," and walks away. I'm like, "Bro, shit don't change like that." Yeah. But what's yeah. crazy to me is I heard him showing the client this. "Look at this. Oh, it's night and day difference. You're insane. Look at, you're so cut right here and yeah. stuff." We heard him saying this. So when he showed me this and I looked at it, my response was, "No."
Yeah.
Like, this is what you were telling him. Like, "Oh my," basically you're just telling him like, "Oh my God, you can see all your abs coming in. You can see the," I'm like,
"Dog, you know how long that takes?"
Yeah. But if people get brainwashed, dude, I mean,
it's not two weeks.
I could have you stare at this picture and keep selling you this and you'll probably start seeing that shit. Right.
Yeah.
But no, it's like, it's crazy that in the fitness industry, that shit's fucking crazy. I see it all the time.
And a lot of these people that are like trainers or coaches, a lot of the times they believe their own hype. Like mm-hmm. they believe that they're that great. So in their mind, they don't know what they're doing is wrong per se. Is that they just think that, oh yeah, this is how you're supposed to do things. And then they implant that to other people.
Yeah. And people like coaches, they feel that way about themselves and you can see it. I can't tell you. I think I've had 4 clients, right? That I've coached, right? Coached them for like 6-7 months, did a couple meets and stuff. And they straight up told me it was like a big thing for them. "Oh, I'm sorry, Alex. I just, you know, I want to try something new. I'm going to go." I'm like, "Oh yeah, that's cool. Dude, yeah. go learn something new."
Yeah.
Like, and I can't tell you every single one of those 4 people. Oh, the same reaction. "Oh my God, I'm so happy. I thought you were going to be so mad." But it's because people, coaches like that actually do. And usually yeah. those are the coaches that don't know shit.
They're full of shit.
They get so mad that you're leaving them. "Oh, that's money." It's like, dude, I don't care. We've worked together for 7 months. This is the way I train. This is yeah. my style. If you feel like you want to go learn something new, go learn something new. I never claim I'm the best coach. I never claim yeah. any of that. But I think I know a good amount of stuff. Mm-hmm. But I'm never scared to keep learning.
Yeah.
I always keep learning shit. There's shit that you showed me that I've mm-hmm. used. I'm never scared to learn anything. But mm-hmm. a lot of these coaches, they have this ego. "Well, I do this much weight, so this is the way you're supposed to do it." It's like, it's not true, my guy.
Yeah.
It's really not.
You're doing that way with shitty form, so
exactly,
what's the point?
Yeah. Let's see how long you do it that yeah. way, because shit, I'm pretty sure your shit's going to get fucked up.
Like, training is very simple in theory, but there's so much nuance that goes into it.
Yep.
And it's I don't say constantly changing, but there's so much that, there's so many different variables.
Mm-hmm. It evolves. That, yeah, I think anything evolves.
Yeah. And
just like sports and even fighting.
Just the variables alone can change everything. And if you don't have someone, a third party looking in on it and being objective in what you're doing or how you're training or how you're eating, it's really hard for you to kind of see that yourself, yeah. you know? So it's just like, there's just a lot, especially in fitness, there's a lot of nonsense that goes on that like people don't really talk about as much.
Yeah. Yeah. My biggest thing that I tell people, if you are in like powerlifting and stuff, is don't be scared to learn stuff. And if your coach says that this is the only thing that works, yeah. don't listen to them.
Yeah.
Get yourself a new coach. You yeah. should always be willing to learn. I think personally, like if you're having a coach, like in powerlifting specifically, right? Or that style, like fighting and stuff's obviously different, right? Mm-hmm. And stuff like that. But in powerlifting, once you're with the coach for like 6-7 months and you start hitting a plateau, usually you're going to start, it's going to be the same, right? That's when you need to start doing stuff, because I've already seen a lot of coaches that stick with a very similar thing. Like a lot of coaches that only squat, only bench, only deadlift. Yeah. There's no accessories. There's no nothing to yeah. that, right? And they say, this is the way it's supposed to be. This is all you need to do. I'm like, I don't agree with that yeah. though, because it's not, because I've tried that. That didn't work for me. Mm-hmm. I had to add in these extra things to start seeing my numbers go up.
Yeah.
And a lot of yeah. people don't realize that what I just said. Just because it works for you does not mean exactly. it works for absolutely everybody else.
You'll see that a lot is like people will take their own training as a coach. Of course, oh, this worked for me. And they'll try to implant it on you. But everyone has a different, there's so many variables.
That try out different coaching. If you're a powerlifter, you're getting up in it right now, doing that, try out different coaching, try out different programs. Don't feel bad to go with a coach for 6 months. If you have good success, don't feel bad to be like, oh, you know, I want to go try something new. Let me go try this person out. Yeah. This person really likes their coach. Let me go see what it is. Don't feel scared about that, because at the end of the day, no one's getting paid in powerlifting. That's why I don't understand. People get so fucking caught up in this shit. It's like, bro.
That's good advice. All right, Nick, I'm done with you. All right, cool. Sure. Perfect.
But for real, it, like, yeah, yep. It's no, like, you're not getting paid unless you're a top powerlifter. You're not getting paid. So it's, you know.
Does this mean David's going to go into powerlifting?
He should.
Oh, man, I'm too long for that shit, man.
You should, bro. You should.
Let's just start powerlifting.
You don't even have to powerlift. Just strength train. Do the three basic movements of a squat, bench, deadlift. Do some accessory movements around that to build up a strong foundation for yourself. So all this stuff, like you have, like your back pain, these little, your posture and all that stuff. You can fix all that.
Let me tell y'all, man, I just don't want to be perfect. It's hard, man. I'm already close to
it. Hey, you really close too, daddy. That's why I'm looking at you like, please, daddy, just do it.
You're almost there, dude. You're almost there. You can achieve 100%.
When the gyms open up, I'm back in it, dude.
We're going to start powerlifting. I'm going to start powerlifting too. Let's powerlift together.
Okay, when the gyms start opening up, dude. All right, man.
No, but you started training with us. You were doing pretty well.
I know, but it's just, it was so painful being sore. Yeah. It's so painful.
You just got to take it easy. Just slow.
Your training should make you better. That's what it's all about, guys.
You guys are fucking losers. Anyways, guys, that wraps up this episode of the Genius Brain Podcast.
Follow your dreams.
Follow your dreams.
Follow your dreams, bro.
Yep. You guys can catch us on Spotify, iTunes, and any kind of audio platforms. We have the Big Mad Podcast in here. That's Big Mad with 3 G's in it. That's Alex Acosta and Nick Dundun.
And Pat's part of that too. Oh, have Pat. You seen Pat on this, this podcast too.
Pat was on this podcast. Pat, hilarious as well, man. But we'll see you all next time, talking all this other bullshit. You guys already know we're here to be with you on your commute, just to have conversation. And love you long time.
I love you long time. Let's go eat some food that slaps.
Ooh, boo this man. Boo.
Peace. Hey.